My name is Noel Joseph Terence Montgomery Needham. I'm from Great Britain. My Chinese name is Li Yue Sir. I have been to China 9 times in my life, and I am eternally grateful for everything I have learned there. Everywhere I have been able to witness its ancient spirit of science and technology. I feel privileged to have seen firsthand this wonderful creativity, the brightest of minds and the noblest of spirits. From this war-torn Asian country burst vitality that borders on the miraculous. It is in this land where such wisdom abounds that the second act of my life began. This is the chapel of Gonville and Caius College in the University of Cambridge. On the 15th of September 1989, a wedding took place here. The bride and groom had a combined age of over 170. The silver-haired newlyweds, garlanded with lilies, accepted the greetings and good wishes of their guests.
两个新人都年纪不小了，也是老人家了嘛，85岁，一个很简单的婚礼，有牧师主持，然后我们就喝茶。大概有十几二十个，不会超过二十个。他主要的对象都是他朋友，老朋友，因为他那个年龄朋友也不多了。The
bridegroom was Joseph Needham, Fellow of the British Royal Society. His multi-volume Science and Civilization in China is recognized as one of the major academic milestones of the 20th century. His bride was Lu Gwei-Djen, a Chinese-born Life Fellow of Cambridge's Robinson College. The two first met half a century earlier in 1937. That was the year the 33-year-old Lu Gwei-Djen, a native of Nanjing, arrived in Cambridge to undertake postgraduate studies in biochemistry. Her supervisor was Dorothy Moyle Needham, Joseph Needham's wife, later to be known in Chinese as Li Da Fei. Joseph and Dorothy married in 1924. Both were high-flying young academics working in the Hopkins Lab of Cambridge's Department of Biochemistry. Dorothy, like Joseph, was a fellow of the Royal Society and of Gonville and Caius College. According to Joseph, Dorothy was probably the only person who had read through all of his work. In the 1930s, when Lu Gwei-Djen arrived at Cambridge, there were very few Chinese students on campus, let alone female ones, so the Needhams were impressed by this unusual Chinese lady. The three of them often worked together in the library of the biochemistry department. When not engaged in contemporary scientific problems, Lu Gwei-Djen would tell the Needhams about inventions in ancient China. Dorothy liked Lu Gwei-Djen very much and admired her cleverness, perseverance and courage.
Dorothy was supervisor for Gwei-Djen, and they clearly worked very well together, and they published a series of very significant scientific papers.
They often relaxed together in the biochemistry department's lounge. Needham would expound on his latest research, and on occasion, Lu Gwei-Djen would argue vehemently with him, while Dorothy looked on in amusement.
I say Gwei-Djen was very lively and sparkling and sharp also. Dorothy was always very quiet and restrained.
Needham undoubtedly became attracted to Lu Gwei-Djen, and from that began to develop a curiosity about China. At the end of 1942, the star biochemist made a significant decision: to discontinue his research in his specialist field and leave Cambridge for China. From that time on, with extraordinary dedication and persistence, Needham devoted himself to the study of Chinese science and civilization. In the 1980s, Lu Gwei-Djen sold her remaining family property in Nanjing, as well as her two properties at No. 1 and No. 28 Owlston Road in Cambridge. The aim was to build a new home for Needham's collection and research materials.
He collected this series of about Chinese science and culture materials, very valuable. He hoped to have a permanent place, like a research institute, to keep these materials completely and preserved.
With support from Lu Gwei-Djen and the Joseph Needham Foundation for Science and Civilization, an exquisite Oriental-style building gradually took shape in Cambridge. This red two-story building, surrounded by Oriental plants, is Cambridge's Needham Research Institute, established in 1987. From 1971 to 1987, Needham focused on writing the fifth and sixth volumes of The Science and Civilization in China, for which he had to visit China several more times for research and fundraising. During the 1970s, Dorothy Needham started to succumb to Alzheimer's disease. Needham and Lu Gwei-Djen would take turns pushing her around in her wheelchair to get some sun and fresh air.
He always brought her, she was in a wheelchair, but Joseph always made sure that she came out at parties and met the students, so that she was very much part of student life when he entertained his students.
Dorothy Moyle Needham passed away on the 23rd of December 1987. Mourning her loss after their 63 years of marriage, Needham was in such grief that he tripped and fell when leaving home, cutting his face. Dorothy Needham's ashes were placed under the Bodhi tree in front of the Institute. The death of his wife left Needham alone. However, Lu Gwei-Djen had been a key collaborator on the multi-part Volume 5 on Chemistry and Chemical Technology, as well as co-authoring other works with Needham. 2 years later, on September the 15th, 1989, Needham and Lu Gwei-Djen were married, 52 years after they first met.
I think Lu Gwei-Djen's role in Needham's life was vitally important. I mean, I think it's easy just to characterize it as being, you know, he was in love with her and that was it. I think she was a very serious person. You know, she took Chinese science and China and the fate of China terribly seriously. And I think it was that that infected Needham, really, you know, rather than pure love of a particular person.
Needham had become interested in the history of science in the 1940s, when he was writing A History of Embryology. He also initiated the first lecture on the history of science in Cambridge. The arrival of Lu Gwei-Djen in his life undoubtedly opened up a whole new world for Needham. Needham called Lu Gwei-Djen a muse from the East. In the preface to the first volume of Science and Civilization in China, Needham wrote, "It is to these three, and especially to the last named, that the credit of being the hormone or evocator of the present book should be accorded."
Lu Gwei-Djen 出生在一个书香门第，所以他有比较深厚的这个国学的这个基础。
Lu Gwei-Djen once said, "Joseph Needham has built a bridge between our civilizations. I am the arch which sustains the bridge." After their marriage, Needham continued to keep a strict and regular writing schedule, working in separate offices with Lu Gwei-Djen. At noon, Needham would knock on Lu Gwei-Djen's door in opposite of his and had lunch with her. In a letter to a friend, Needham recalled his time after marriage. "I married an old friend of mine, Lu Gwei-Djen, who joined us as early as 1937. 5 days after we tied the knot, we moved to a new house in the Needham Research Institute, where I went to work in my electric wheelchair and came home at 5 o'clock. We lived happily together." It had been in November 1986 that Needham visited China for the last time. During this trip, he specifically proposed a visit to Chichun in Hubei province. Chichun is Li Gwei-Djen's hometown. A pharmacist's daughter, Li Gwei-Djen had shown him the greatness of classical Chinese medicine. Chichun was also the hometown of Li Shizhen. Li Shizhen was a great 16th century scholar, physician, and naturalist whose compendium of Materia Medica was seen as the ultimate authority on the subject. At the cemetery, Needham, his palms clasped together devoutly, paid his respects by circling Li Shizhen's grave 3 times.
"Can I take a picture first?"
"Can I take a picture of him
first?" "Thank you so much."
At the gate of the cemetery, Needham asked the staff to wait and got out his camera once again, as he had been doing for all those decades. Over his lifetime, he took nearly 4,000 photographs of China, which are now housed in the Needham Research Institute in Cambridge. After Military Technology, the Gunpowder Epic was released in 1987, Needham began preparations for the final volumes. Although largely published after his death, the content of Science and Civilization in China has not been subsequently expanded. Over the decades, Lu Gwei-Djen was Needham's earliest and longest collaborator. The two traveled together to China many times. Lu Gwei-Djen accompanied Needham in Beijing, Hong Kong, Shanxi, and Taipei to give lectures and conduct research for the book Science and Civilization in China. She once joked that she was like Needham's walking stick. He would take her with him wherever he went.
With him. I remember seeing them in an airport, I think maybe Guangzhou, can't remember, somewhere in southern China. They were both very elderly by then. This must have been in the 80s. And we were in the airport waiting for a plane. And there were the two of them sitting side by side, both holding a little bag, both the heads back, asleep like that, but two of them. And you just, you know, you thought immediately, this is a pair of people who are, they're not all over each other, they are side by side working together. This is a true partnership.
这是贵正姑妈到南京来的时候和我们全家合影的，肺部感染，住在上海的华东医院。我跟我妈呢就连夜的坐火车到上海去看她，但是确实呢就很瘦，但是呢脸色还不在上海赶回来的，或者和一进病房真是热烈的亲吻，这是真的，这是呢有我说这两老人真是感情。
However, their marriage was to be short-lived. In 1991, 2 years after the wedding, Lu Gwei-Djen broke her hip in a fall. Not long after, the lung disease she had suffered when she was young flared up again. She had difficulty in breathing, her coughing became worse day by day, and she appeared not to respond to treatment. This photo records the last moments of Lu Gwei-Djen's life. She fixed her gaze on Needham for a long time, while Needham held her hand tightly. On November the 28th, 1991, Lu Gwei-Djen passed away peacefully. With his life partner and soulmate leaving one after another, Needham began to age rapidly. For the first time, he felt an inescapable loneliness. His physical condition became worse. His joints creaked, he almost lost sight in one eye, and his hearing began to deteriorate. In front of the hundreds of leather files lined up in his office, Needham could no longer locate the information he needed as quickly as he had in his youth.
I think that Lu Gwei-Djen's death is a very big shock to Nie Se. So his life-force has a big relationship.
Working is the only way for him to relieve the pain. Needham wheeled himself into the office every day, worked for 5 hours, then went home to write personal letters, watch the news, and go to bed. He was accompanied only by books, manuscripts, and objects connected to China. On the window stood the laboratory equipment. A porcelain plate bearing the image of a water-powered astronomical clock tower. A blue and white porcelain vase from a friend on the antique shelf. A portrait of Shen Nong, the divine farmer, hung on the wall. Sketches of himself by Wu Zuoren. All these things to remind him of happier days.
Li Yueshe's 晚年还是比较凄凉的，特别是卢桂珍去世以后，他等于失去一个拐杖，身体就迅速的这个健康状况就开始衰败下来了。本来他有帕金森氏病，这时候就已经手哆得很厉害。
He had a heightened sense of urgency and a million things still to do. Wearing glasses for long-sightedness, Needham studied at his desk every day. By this time, he had finished the first 6 volumes of Science and Civilization in China in a total of 17 parts. There were still 8 parts and the final volume to be finished. Needham had only one goal in mind, to finish his masterwork. And he worked toward this goal every day until the end of his life.
有些人说老先别来了，来了我们还挺麻烦的。但他坚持要来，他一定要来。有时呢，他你想92岁老人，他处理文件，他还是用老师打字机。有时他口授，有时他自己敲敲敲。李老师每天上午10点钟到办公室来。Scholar
Liu Dun studied at the Needham Research Institute when he was young. He even acted as Needham's cook when his housekeeper was away.
他喜欢吃川菜，喜欢吃甜的，也喜欢吃辣的。反正中国饭菜他都说好，他是一个非常客气、非常那个，就是gentleman的人啊，典型的绅士。他什么东西他都要谢谢你啊，thank you indeed，thank you lots，成天挂在口里。Although
his life had changed, his habits remained. As in the past, Needham wrote in his office. Took a nap, woke up, and then wrote some more. Many honors came to be bestowed upon him. In 1992, Queen Elizabeth II made him a Companion of Honour at Buckingham Palace. Needham attended wearing his favourite Chinese chongsam. By this time, he was unable to get out of his wheelchair. For all his glory, Needham was aging irretrievably.
I saw Joseph the last time about 3 weeks before he died. I went to the Needham Institute in Cambridge for a workshop, and Joseph was there in his wheelchair, indomitable as always, in his wheelchair with a pad of paper and a pen, and taking notes, but the notes were no longer very good notes, and he couldn't speak very clearly, and he was obviously not well.
Gonville and Caius College in Cambridge has three gateways that represent three states of life. When students enter the school, they walk through the 700-year-old Gate of Humility. During their study on campus, they pass every day through the Gate of Virtue. Finally, academic success will lead to the Gate of Honor. After years of study and decades of painstaking research, Needham knew he was getting closer to his final passing through the Gate of Honor. One spring day in 1995, Needham had his helper wheel him to the office.
到这里先在对面那边吃了饭，然后到这里坐了一会儿，跟他的助手走了一些事情，大概四点半五点钟也就回去了。他天天都是这样做的。In
an unusual move, he asked his helper to assist him clearing the mountain of documents from his desk to reveal its smooth surface. The next day, March the 24th, his colleagues at the Institute were surprised that he did not appear at his usual time. He passed away peacefully that evening in his 95th year. In nearly a century of life, he had striven to bring change to the world. On March 31st, Needham's coffin was taken from his college's chapel, where it had been lying, as was the custom, for college fellows, for his final farewell to the university. It was a special honor for Needham. The coffin, escorted by the fellows of the college, passed the paths, lawns, and historic buildings of Gonville and Caius. It was as if Needham was bidding farewell to every tree and blade of grass. A subsequent memorial service was held for Needham at St. Mary's Cathedral in central Cambridge on June the 10th. In front of the cathedral, people danced Needham's favorite Morris dance to commemorate the polymath in a joyful way. His friends and contemporaries were few. Most were the students, colleagues and people who had received help from him and who admired his academic achievements.
I was the woman collaborator there, and there were two men collaborators there, and they were both crying. Men don't usually cry in England, but they were crying. I think for many of the men who worked with him, he was a father figure.
Under the Bodhi tree in front of the Needham Research Institute in Cambridge, Joseph Needham and his two beloved wives were reunited forever. In May 1990, with the approval of the Minor Planet Center, the Purple Mountain Observatory of China named the newly discovered asteroid 2790 as the Needham asteroid. It took him nearly half a century to write the voluminous Science and Civilization in China, which illustrates China's historical contribution to science and technology in such detail. Looking up at the vast expanse of sky, Needham asteroid hangs far above the Earth. Just as Needham had done in his lifetime, he looked at the civilizations in the East and the West equally, both from the perspective of the universe. Needham's old office in the biochemistry department is now occupied by Professor Alan Furst, a chemist and, like Needham, a fellow of the Royal Society and a former master of the Gonville and Caius College. On the wall of the room, there are four Chinese characters, which may have been written by Lu Gwei-Djen.
This was Joseph Needham's room until 1991, one of his two rooms. And there's some Chinese calligraphy here, and I believe it says, "A person may go away, but their influence remains." After Joseph Needham left this room, Stephen Hawking came here and occupied this room for many, many years. Unfortunately, he died this year in October when I cease to become master, and I shall be moving in here, and I will be greatly honoured to have been in a room that was occupied both by Joseph Needham and Stephen Hawking.
After Needham's death, his research institute in Cambridge continues the study of science and civilization in China. The subsequent directors of the Needham Research Institute, Ho-Peng Yo Ke and Mr. Christopher Cullen, took great pains to continue his work. Ho-Peng Yo Ke, the institute's second director, even gave up his comfortable life in Australia to continue Needham's unfinished work for free. Thanks to the concerted efforts of Needham supporters around the world, the Needham Research Institute has been hosting visiting scholars from China for more than 20 years and has also opened its doors to international scholars studying science and technology in East Asia. Up to now, more than 200 scholars from different countries have visited here. In 1994, Mei Zhenjun, a scholar at Beijing's University of Science and Technology, came to study here. Today, he is the fourth director of the institute.
我希望呢，这个我们这个研究所还能够继续的，按照这个李约瑟先生的生前的这个遗愿，能够继续发挥他在沟通中西文化、沟通中西文明，能够提供这样一个平台。
After Needham's death, it became an urgent task for the Needham Research Institute to complete his unfinished work and publish the remaining volumes as soon as possible. The seventh volume, the much-anticipated conclusion chapter, was finally published in 2004, thanks to the efforts of Editor-in-Chief Christopher Cullen and Editor Kenneth Robinson. So far, this remarkable work comprises 25 published books, the most recent being Volume 6, Part 4, Traditional Botany, which completed in 2015. Eventually, the masterwork will be completed with two more parts, making a total of 27. In the Institute for the History of Natural Sciences, Chinese Academy of Sciences, professionals in various fields have continued to translate Needham's work. In 1991, the composition of the 26-part History of Science and Technology in Pre-Modern China, with Lu Jiaxu as the editor-in-chief, was started to systematically record scientific development and achievements in China. At Tsinghua University, young students are attracted by the seminar Needham's World and Needham in the World. At the University of Hong Kong, the Joseph Needham Special Collections Room opened at the end of 2018 in the university's main library. In 1994, Needham was awarded the Albert Einstein Gold Medal by UNESCO. In the same year, Needham was honored as one of the first foreign academicians of the Chinese Academy of Sciences. Needham has been awarded titles or honorary titles in 13 countries, and his research is widely respected around the world. Science and Civilization in China, pioneered and written or edited by Needham personally, is regarded as one of the great academic achievements of the 20th century. It allows the world to reappraise the contribution of Chinese civilization to the progress of human civilization as a whole. It further ushers in a new perspective and a new era of cross-cultural comparative research. Needham emphasized the interaction and influence among different civilizations on mankind. He proposed that in the evolutionary model of modern science, the older streams of science in different civilizations are like rivers flowing into the ocean of modern sciences. He particularly stressed the role of science in the integration of human civilizations. His spirit lives on after his death. His vision enabled him to find a then-neglected China and open a dialogue between Eastern and Western civilizations. His life ended, but his story and his contribution to the world will live in history.